Hello, and welcome to the Dark Matter Knits podcast. I'm Elizabeth Green Musselman, and it is March 28th, 2015. This is episode 28, Vive la Différence. That was my best French pronunciation. I know it's not perfect, but I'm trying. So, hi, everybody. I'm recording a day late because we just had a lot going on yesterday. We had a wedding to go to last night. My voice is a little husky today as a result. It was a very loud wedding. It was a very fun wedding. And yeah, I did a lot of shouting because when you have a voice, a baritone voice like mine, and you're trying to talk in a crowded room, it just blends right into the background. So yeah. And then today we took my son over to his middle school and got him all signed up for, he took a math test to kind of do a math placement sort of thing. And so, yeah, it's been a busy weekend, but finally I am able to record, and my other two family members are here right now, so hopefully they will not be walking in while we're recording. So I have a whole hodgepodge of things to talk about with you today, and it's just one of those weeks where there's a lot going on and a lot to talk about, but kind of the general theme for today is international knitting and podcasts. So kind of the two of the main segments that I want to get to a little later are some international podcasts that I really enjoy, and I'm certainly going to welcome you to share with me the ones that you love. And I have a wonderful stash of French knitting magazines from the 80s and early 90s that were gifted to me recently, and I have to show them to you because, man, are they fabulous. I'm not going to show them all to you, of course. I mean, I've seriously, like, I've got a stack that is probably about, it's about 2 feet high. It's huge. I will explain where these came from, where this bounty came from in a moment. But I made a selection of a few choice issues that kind of give you a sense of the wonderful range that is available in these magazines. So that's kind of the core of what I want to talk about today. But I have a whole bunch of little oddments to speak with you about in the meantime, or before we get to that. So one of them is that I wanted to say thank you to Sandy for her very generous donation. Thank you, Sandy. And to my mom. My mom made a donation to the podcast. She heard me talking about how I was saving up for a camera, and then she made a donation. Thank you, Mom. It was nice of you. So now I really need to get the camera. I haven't done that yet, but I am planning to do that before the next episode. We have a giveaway from the last episode that I need to wrap up, and that is for Canadian Art Deco Knits. And I am so glad. So I asked you to answer the question, give me the name of a building, and hopefully, you know, post a picture as well, but a building or an architectural style that you think would make a great inspiration for a knitted piece. And I felt a little cruel asking it because I thought, man, I don't know if anybody's gonna even want to answer that question. Like, it's a little bit tough. But I'm so glad I asked because there were some really, really interesting answers to the question. You've got to go take a look. There were some wonderful, one of the ones that immediately jumps to mind is Gojen posted a photo of this beautiful mosaic tile that she had seen, and I forget where it was, but you've got to go see. There's some really great ideas in there. Some of them Art Deco and many of them not. The winner was number 13, who is Penny Gale, and she said that she would love to see something inspired by a Roman aqueduct or the actual Colosseum, which is a great idea. There's that, those structures would definitely make, would I think be easily interpreted, or not easily, but you know, could be interpreted well into a stitch pattern, maybe something cabled or lace, and would look really, really cool. So thank you all for your really interesting answers to that question. And I will let Natalie Servant, the author of, the designer behind Canadian Art Deco Knits, know, Penny Gale, that you won that collection. So she'll be sending you a copy of it. So you'll get the three patterns that have come out so far, and then as the new ones come out, she will send those to you as well. I have an update too about the Blocare Cap Cowl. So this is the sport weight multicolored color block hat that I designed, and we're doing a cowl right now, a knit along in the Dark Matter Knits group. And that has been going on since March 1st, but the knit along is going on through April 15th. So there is still plenty of time to join if you would like to. I wanted to show you, because I haven't yet, I've kind of finally gathered them all together. I wanted to show you some of the prizes for the knit along. And the way this is going to work, because I've explained this briefly in the group, but I haven't. My son is cocking and loading his Nerf gun in the background. I really hope you can't hear that. Like over and over and over again. distracted. Prizes for the Blocare Cap Cowl. So the way this is going to work is that there's just an open discussion thread for the knit along, and I'm not going to start a separate finished object thread, although that is the standard practice. What I've just decided to do, because there aren't like hundreds or even dozens of people knitting this hat, it's a manageable number of people. So I'm just going to go through and write down the numbers of each of the posts where there's a photo of a finished hat, and I'll just draw from those numbers. So that's relatively easy. I've got prizes that I've picked up for different for people who have finished the hat, and I'll randomly choose from those numbers. So one of them is a skein of a new yarn from Knit Picks called Hawthorn Sport. And this is a superwash fine Highland wool, and that's 80% that and 20% polyamide, which is a nylon. So this is designed primarily to be a sock yarn, but I think it could certainly, be used for other, make a great hat or toy or shawl even. It's a 258 yard, so it's pretty generous yardage. You could certainly get a pair of socks out of this. So I have that. I have an oldie but a goodie. This is a DVD from 2007, I believe. Yeah, by Lucy Neatby. And it is one of her wonderful knitting DVDs. This is Knitting Gems 4. So it's a collection of tips for different kinds of cast-ons, methods for making tubular edges, decorative twined chain and scallops, increases, fancy bind-offs, and daring rescue techniques. I love Lucy Neatby. She's so great. This is a really good DVD. I'm giving it away because I've had it for a while. I've watched it several times. I doubt I'll watch it again, but it's excellent. I also have. This prize is really nice, I have to say. I picked this up at DFW Fiber Fest, about which more in a moment. This is a project bag that is based on the Outlander series done by Suburban Stitcher, Diane, of the Suburban Stitcher podcast. And she makes project bags, and she made this lovely bag. Why? Oh, yeah. I'm like, why is there something in here? It's a pocket Jamie. So Jamie is one of the characters from Outlander. So if you're a fan, I will tuck him in here. I'll be sure to leave the zipper a little unzipped so that he won't suffocate in here. But this is her tag. And what I thought was especially fun about this bag, a couple of things. For one thing, Suburban Stitcher makes beautiful bags. So this is a nice size for really any accessory. I think a small shawl would fit in here, socks, hats, that sort of thing. And so it's beautifully made for one thing. For another thing, this tartan she had woven specially for this. It is the exact tartan that, wrong side, that Jamie wears. See? It's hard to see the red in this picture, but it's the correct tartan. So she had that woven in Scotland, and guess what? The fabric showed up. The fabric was supposed to show up 6 weeks before DFW, when she was supposed to have all these bags for sale, and it showed up 6 days before the show. Oh, man. So she had to sew like a mad woman. I also thought that this would make a great bag to pick up for a prize for our podcast because we have a lot of male viewers, and I thought that this was a good gender-neutral project bag, which is not a common thing, as my male knitter friends well know. So this is one of the prizes for the Blokari Cap Cowl. I believe that, by the way, I believe Diana's making more of these because she had time to make some of the bags for DFW, but not others, as you might imagine. So I believe that she is going to have more of these in her shop if you like this, but, you know, don't plan on knitting the hat. And then I will also be sharing a collection of some of my favorite of the French knitting magazines. I have, like I said, I have a pile of them, so I'm going to pull together a group of them and send them off as another prize. So that's fun. So the Blokari Cap Cowl going on Ravelry right now. It is in the Dark Matter Knits group. You will easily find the thread there. DFW Fiber Fest is, I went there last weekend and it was super fun. If you watch the Bookish Stitcher podcast, you have already heard about a good portion of my trip already, because I spent a lot of it with Jeanette of Bookish Stitcher, who is even more sweet in person than she is in her podcast, which is hard to imagine. Jeanette, very kindly, she lives in San Antonio, which is further, so it's San Antonio's down here, Austin's here, and Dallas is up here. So she very sweetly agreed to pick me up basically on the way up to Dallas, and we had a wonderful time talking in the car. I mean, it just felt like, you know, those people that you meet them for the first time and it's like you've known each other forever, like you just have no difficulty talking to each other at all. It was like that. It was lovely. And so we had a great time talking on the way up, although it was pouring rain, and poor Jeanette got the worst of it, so she was just white-knuckling it all the way up to Dallas. So we got there a lot later than we had intended, but we had a really nice time on Friday night. We got to see Franklin Habit speak, who is a really excellent speaker. I mean, I shouldn't be surprised by that, but I never necessarily expect people who are great writers to be great speakers, because those two things don't necessarily go hand in hand. I've always enjoyed Franklin Habit's writing, but I just, you know, I decided not to have too high expectations about his speaking. And, but he was great. It was a really interesting talk about five women in his family who have had an important impact on his creative development, and very, very touching stories. His family, you know, comes from all over. His extended ancestry sort of comes from many parts of Europe and the Middle East. And so he just had, you know, really interesting stories about, you know, first and second generation immigrants in the United States. And then he had designed shawls to sort of reflect each of these different women. And so he explained, you know, how each of the different elements of the shawls reflected how he felt about them and their character and all that. And it was really interesting. Then Jeanette and I went and got Indian food afterwards, which was delicious. So good. I love Indian food. And then Saturday, I spent most of the day with Anne Podlasek of Willy Wonka Fibers, who is my Stitch Definition business partner. But she was there in her capacity, mainly in her capacity as the dyer behind Willy Wonka, and had a booth there. So I was helping her out in her booth, mainly just so I could spend a good chunk of time with her, and also because it's nice to be able to go to the bathroom every once in a while when you're running a booth by yourself. So spent a good portion of the day with her, which was wonderful, and it was fun to see how well her booth was doing. In fact, the vendors seemed to be doing quite well, which was great. And then I had some time in various points of the day to walk around the market, and part of it with Jeanette and with Heidi of Undead Yarn, and with some other friends, and, you know, just got to catch up with people, and I don't know. I've been in Texas long enough and have been to enough shows in Texas to have, you know, gotten to know a lot of the vendors in this area and the people who kind of go that circuit. So it's just always fun to catch up with people. And I got to see Robin of October House again and her husband Jimmy, and they are so nice. And it was great to, I think this was their second show ever, so that was really cool to see them there, and people were just mobbing their booth. Got to see Stacy and Diane and Steph and in the Mustache Yarn booth. And just kind of wandered all over the place. I didn't get much. I just got the bag. And one other thing, Miss Babs was there. And Miss Babs, the only other time I see them is at Rhinebeck. And at Rhinebeck, they are mobbed from like the minute the gates open on the first day to the minute the gates close. There is a line out the door and around the block to get to Miss Babs. They were at DFW Fiber Fest and there was no line. I was like, get me over there. So I picked up a skein of this, a skein of pink, which is so not me. What was I doing? But I love it. It's a babette. I'm sure it means something, but I don't know what it means. It's a yowza skein. I think babette means that it's a one of a kind, I think. But anyway, it's the Verassing. I think that's how you say that. Verassing colorway. So yowza is a giant skein of light worsted, so kind of a DK weight yarn. No, it's really, it's a worsted. And it has 560 yards in it, so that's the yowza. And I'm not normally into pink, but I love a hot pink crosses over into my territory of love. And then she got me, hooked me with the browns and the oranges in there, which is just fun. You know, like you don't normally expect to see that with a hot pink. Do something unusual and you're gonna get my attention. So yeah, this is, if you've not come across Miss Babs before, this is their card. And Babs Auscherman in Tennessee is the proprietrix behind this business. She is a lovely person and has really cool, really cool color sensibility. So that's all I got, other than the bag. I know. it's like a sickness, the not buying yarn. So I did a little bit of spending, and then I also ran into Cindy Telesak, who is this gorgeous person right here. And that is her dog, one of her dogs. And she wrote this book called Giving Away the Farm, How Kindness, Critters, and Yarn Knit a Community Together. She self-published this book, and it is an excellent book. I edited this, so I have read this multiple times, and really think that she is a very soulful and thoughtful person. The book is about, the reason I'm talking about this book, by the way, is because she gave me this copy to give away to you. So this is a giveaway for this week, which was very kind of her. This book is about how Cindy started her farm, Jacob's Reward Farm, which is here in Texas, and why she did, and how she built a community there. It is a really interesting, thoughtful account of how to build community in a number of ways, but you know, particularly around fiber, what works and what doesn't, and why this community has really, really thrived. I will tell you, Cindy is one of the warmest, sweetest people I have ever met. She's one of those people that you get around her and you just immediately feel your blood pressure drop. Do you know what I mean? Just genuinely warm. And I think it's one of the reasons why the community around her farm works so well. And but she also really thinks through the various aspects of that really well. So basically, Jacob's Reward Farm has a knitting group that meets there every week, but they also do, you know, shearing days, and, you know, there's just a lot of community around the farm. And yeah, I wish I lived closer. So it would take me about 4 hours to get to where she is, so it's not really feasible for me, but Texas is so flippin' big. Anyways, Giving Away the Farm. This is a book for one of you, and I will ask you to answer the question, what is something that you most want in a knitting group? Or crochet group, crafting group in general is fine. It's either, and that can either be something that you have now in your group or that you wish that you had. I have been in some knitting groups that I loved and some that I, you know, could sort of take or leave. So, you know, we've all been there, right? So that is our giveaway for the week. And so yeah, Saturday we, there were no events that night. I didn't take any classes. I just worked in the vendor hall and you know, met up with friends. There was a podcaster meetup that afternoon, which ended up mostly being podcasters talking to each other, which was totally fine. I love meeting the other podcasters. And Saturday night we went out for Japanese food, which was very cool because Jeanette had never had Japanese food before. So it was really fun bossing her around and telling her what to order. She's vegetarian, so I was like, get the vegetable tempura. yeah, so that was really fun. And yeah, Sunday morning, got up really early and booked it back to Austin and San Antonio with Jeanette again. Super fun. I love DFW Fiber Fest. Such a great show. Also, there's just so much going on today, this week, these 2 weeks. I finished working on another giant project. Defarge Does Shakespeare. So this is one of the last projects that I'm wrapping up for Cooperative Press. I have a pattern in the book, which I'll show you in a moment, but I also did all the main work that I did on the book was book design and layout and photography. I didn't shoot the photographs. Well, I did shoot some of them, but I organized the photo shoot that Caro Sheridan did the photos, the main set of photos. I'm sorry, I'm really... really tired from last night. I'm not hungover, but I'm tired. Just a little draggy today. Look at this guy. This guy. Hello. Hello. I am the bard. apparently I'm also punchy. This is a design that was given away as a promotion for, if you pre-ordered Defarge Does Shakespeare, you got a copy of the pattern to make We Will, who is obviously a doll of William Shakespeare. Isn't he great? He's a little floppy-headed. Donna Payton, P-E-Y-T-O-N, designed him, and I think she did a fabulous job. She also has designed a Chaucer doll for the next book, Defarge Goes Medieval, so. And I think she's doing a Sherlock for the Sherlock book, which will be the last one in the Defarge series. Hilarious. I love that he's got the bald pate. He's just really well designed. I love his little poofy pants. And there's actually very little seaming in this, which is brilliant. So anyway, Defarge Does Shakespeare is a book of, it's in a series of books called What Would Madame Defarge Knit? And it's based on, in Tale of Two Cities, a Charles Dickens book, there is a character named Madame Defarge who is set during the French Revolution. She's sympathetic with the revolutionaries, and she is knitting the names of aristocracy, of people that she considers traitors, into something that she is knitting. But Dickens never tells you, she's a very key character in the book, but Dickens never says what she is knitting. So Heather Ordover of the Craftlit podcast years ago decided this would make a great pretext for a knitting book, would be to ask people, what do you think Madame Defarge is knitting? And for that matter, let's expand the theme and say, what would classic characters in literature be wearing or knitting? design something for one of your favorite characters. So the first two books are just what would Madame Defarge knit, what else would Madame Defarge knit, and they're kind of any characters, like all over the map from different parts of literature. And then she's doing three themed books, and the first of those is Defarge Does Shakespeare. So these are all Shakespeare-inspired designs. And mine are a pair of socks. Because when I think of knitting and Shakespeare, there wasn't a lot of knitting in Shakespeare's time, because knitting had just arrived in England at that point. But hose, socks, were some of the first knitted things to be made. And if you've ever seen Twelfth Night, you know that Malvolio, who is one of the sort of satirical characters, or comic characters, well, it's a comedy, but he's mocked relentlessly in Twelfth Night. He wears yellow gartered stockings because he has been told falsely that the lady that he serves finds him attractive and particularly loves it when he wears yellow gartered stockings. So that was an obvious choice. And in fact, there are three Malvolio stocking patterns in the book, and they are all completely different, and they're all really cool, if I do say so myself. I didn't design all of them. So mine are a pair of men's socks that look for all the world like regular gold toe socks until you get up to the calf, and then they have these cool, it basically shapes the calf so that it expands outward where your, you know, calf starts to widen, and puts these cables at the top. So what I like about this idea is that if you are knitting for a man who has, you know, more conservative tastes, or you are yourself a man knitting for yourself and, you know, don't like to have a lot of color, this allows you to have some color while, you know, you can kind of hide all of this in the top of your pants, and nobody ever has to be the wiser if you don't want them to be. There is also another version that has ties at the top, just for a little extra funsies. So there is a size that will suit most women's feet and a size that will suit most men's feet. It is called The Yellow Gartered Dude Abides, because they couldn't all be called Malvolio stockings. So mine, this is Heather's idea, Heather Ordover, the editor of the book, she had the brilliant idea of calling them The Yellow Gartered Dude Abides, which I think is hilarious because I love The Big Lebowski. And yeah, so that's this pattern, which is available for the moment in the book, and about roughly a year from now you can get it as an individual pattern. I had a lot of fun doing these. Oh, yarn. This is a yarn that is unfortunately kind of no longer in existence. This is Cephalopod Yarns Bugga. So this is the sport weight version. You can do this really in any, I think this would look good in any semi-solid sport sock yarn. Cephalopod Yarns unfortunately has gone out of business, but the Verdant Griffin, which used to be in the same business with Cephalopod Yarns, they also carry the Bugga base and dye it in similarly beautiful colors. So you can still find a version of this yarn. So there's that. And then today, Knitting Daily, my spot aired. I totally lost track of that and didn't see it. I think my life is getting... Your life is officially getting too hectic when you forget you're going to be on TV and you don't see it. Disappointed. I mean, I've got it on DVD, but it's kind of cool when it's like the minute it's on the air to see it, you know? Because then it's like real television. It's not like straight to DVD. So that. Here's what I'm knitting. In more news, I needed something. This happens to me every time I go to a show. I go into a panic. Well, not panic. A mild freak out. Because most of my knitting is work knitting. It's design knitting. I have to pay attention to it. I have to take notes on it. Therefore, it does not make good show knitting. So like usually the night before I leave for the show, I'm like, ah, I need something that I don't have to concentrate on to knit. So I talk to myself in that voice. So I decided to dig something out of my relatively deep stash and knit something relatively simple. So I have this on the needles. That's pretty true to color. It's a little greener than that, a little more turquoise. That's better. This is a honey cowl, as you many of you will probably already recognize. And the yarn is turning into a giant mess. But it is this. It is a yarn from White Bear Fibers, which I believe has also gone out of existence. It is their sport weight. It is the week of sport weight. And the Mother Earth base, I guess. It's a superwash merino, and the colorway. Oh, the colorway is Mother Earth. That makes sense. Green and blue. It's like a globe. It's like the Earth seen from space. So, it's White Bear Sport Base Mother Earth colorway. That's what it is. Phew. Can't pull the wool over my eyes. So, God, you'd think I was drunk. I'm actually, like, I have slept well, and I am completely sober. So yeah, honey cowl, I am working on this. I have screwed this up so many times. It boggles the mind. I think it is one of those classic things. I'm constantly getting like one stitch off and discovering it 2 rows later. I think the problem is it's in that classic sweet spot between it's just complex enough that you do kind of have to be paying attention, but it's just simple enough that you don't. Do you do this? Because with like a stockinette, I'm fine, you know. Do 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 do. Like I might drop a stitch or like split yarn if I'm not looking, you know, every now and then, but I'm fine doing stockinette. But if there's just a little bit of a pattern, or if it's super complicated, you know, then I'm focusing on it, and I tend not to make too many mistakes, really. Knock on wood. But if it's just a little past simple, I will mess it up repeatedly. I've ripped back so many times on this, but I like it. I'm enjoying knitting it, and it's a great project, and it's a fun free pattern, fine. Okay, I think that is enough of that. The big two things for today, 33 minutes in. I will try to keep this relatively brief. Some international podcasts that I love. I thought as long as I was talking about some French knitting magazines, I would also talk about some podcasts from outside the US that I really enjoy. I like watching and listening to a lot of different podcasts, although I don't often have the time to keep up with them as well as I would like. But I enjoy the variety of podcasts that are available, and I particularly like it when I can find something where somebody does something a little different. And including when somebody who from outside the US does a podcast that happens to be in English. It's not like I expect it to be in English, but it is the language I speak, so it is, well, that in German. Anyways, I enjoy seeing the kinds of things that people knit and talk about and do in their leisure time and what patterns and colors they find enjoyable. It's just interesting. It's, just a different kind of perspective than what their LYSs are like, what kind of events they go to. It's just a whole different experience. So, one of the ones that I really enjoy, and you know this if you saw my post from when I had all the technical troubles with the last episode. I posted in lieu of my episode, which was delayed, go watch the sock mattician, Nathan. He is a new podcaster, very new. He has 2 episodes up so far. New podcaster out of the UK. He lives in London. And I just love him. I love his podcast. And I think it's because I think it's because of vanity. So for one thing, he has said very nice things about me on his podcast. So vanity point number one. For another thing, he seriously could be my twin separated at birth. We do not look at all alike, but we have just a very similar way of thinking about things and approaching things. And I guess I like watching a male, English male version of myself talking on camera. Wow, that sounds so bad. I am so not editing that out. Although, I really should. Wow, I think I actually made myself blush. I don't do that very often. I am not easily embarrassed. Okay, so, I love this aquatician. Go check him out. He is very interesting and is a professional actor and singer by trade, and both in terms of performing and teaching. So that's fun. And he did aired a portion of a documentary that he and his husband recorded of their wedding, where they did their entire wedding as a musical. Dude, I totally want to see that documentary. They actually won an award, a documentary award, for this film that they did. And it's lovely. It's very touching. Don't even know the guy, and I was like bawling my eyes out at this clip that he showed on his podcast. And he does beautiful double knitting designs, and just has very interesting ways of talking about what he knits and designs. Yeah, I think he's great. So I have a question for you, Nathan, because I know you watch the podcast. And please don't feel bad if you don't see this for like even a few weeks from now. It's just, I want you to answer a question for me. What skein in your stash do you think says the most about you? That may be an evil question. So you could reframe it if you choose as, what skein in your stash do you think says something interesting about you? That's slightly less pressure. If you want to pose an evil question back to me, you are more than welcome, and I will answer it. Okay. And no, I do not really think you are an English male version of myself. Wow. That seriously sounds like the most self-centered thing I have ever said in my entire life. All right, so moving on to other podcasts that I love. Also in the UK, Tilly Trout. Love me some Tilly Trout. She is in somewhere in Northern England. I'm forgetting now exactly where she lives. She is hilarious. I mean, just completely herself and so English. She totally epitomizes to me one of the kind of charming English archetypes. I've spent a lot of time in England, so I there are just certain kinds of English personalities that I find absolutely charming, and hers is one of them. You'll just have to, I can't describe it. You'll have to go see her. She's got dogs. She likes to be outside. She surprises you with, you think she's a certain way, and then she'll knit something, and you're like, I never would have expected you to knit that. She's great. Also, as long as we're in the UK, I love Jolie's Kitchen. She happens to be my tech editor, but I think she's an American who lives in the UK and has, you know, sort of that interesting perspective on things. Bakery Bears, I also really enjoy. That is a very popular one. One of the things I like about them is that they really take advantage of where they are. You get to see a lot of England through that podcast. They spend a lot of time filming and editing it. It's quite a production. In Australia, I really enjoy the Yarnder Woman podcast. She has just this really great sort of gothy look, and she goes to lots of Comic-Cons, and she's really into Wonder Woman, which explains the name of her podcast. So I love watching her because she's not only is she Australian, so has this whole other, you know, kind of vantage point on the knitting community, but also has this kind of cool geek girl kind of thing going on, which is Super fun. In South Africa, I love pink hair girl knits. Love her. Pink hair, of course. And I have also spent some time in South Africa, so it's just, and she lives in Cape Town, which is the part I visited, so it makes me somewhat nostalgic, but I also just really enjoy hearing her her point of view on, you know, what's available and what she likes to knit and you know, how people get together in South Africa for knitting groups, and you know, it's just it's fascinating. Deese's craft work I also really enjoy. She, oh, I forgot to look up. It's been a while since I've caught up with her podcast, so I am suddenly forgetting. Sweden? Is she from Sweden? I think that's right. But her podcast is in English, and yeah, she, I really like her because she doesn't, she just talks about what's on her mind, and doesn't, you know, kind of over-censor herself in terms of trying to be delicate, which I really appreciate about her. There was a, she had some really, has kind of an ongoing difficulty with walking alone with her dog. There are these men who harass her in town, which is really disturbing. And she's talked very frankly about how she deals with that, which I've found very interesting. I mean, I'm not happy this is happening to her, but it's been interesting hearing her talk about her dealing with that. And there are many, many others, but those are some of my current favorites, and I would be very interested in hearing what yours are. So I will, that is one of the questions I will pose to you in the discussion thread for this week is what are some of your favorite podcasts that are from outside the United States? Now, I realize that for some of you, you are not in the US, but there are lots of podcasts in the US, and I think I would just like to hear about, even if you are yourself from outside the US, tell me about some of your favorite podcasts that are also filmed outside the US. Okay, last thing. Oh, and I also have to do a technique segment, and I haven't figured out what that is yet. But I'll stop the tape and figure that out later. In the meantime, let's look at French knitting magazines from the 1980s. Oh gosh, I was just so excited. So my husband asked me not to go into too many details about this because he knows I'm going to kind of make fun of these magazines a little bit. And he doesn't want this to come across seeming ungrateful, which I am totally not. I am not ungrateful. As you well know, mockery is not lack of gratitude. Anyways, back to my story. There is a very kind woman, couple, who are French, who live in this area. And they know my husband, and they know that I knit. And they hadn't met me before. So she, who is the knitter, asked my husband if I would be interested in. She doesn't knit anymore, so she was getting rid of all of her knitting paraphernalia, magazines, yarn, needles. Would I be interested in them? Oh, heck yeah, I'm interested. So I knew that probably the yarn was not going to be the gold part of this collection, right? Which I was right. It was mostly acrylic, and I ended up destashing almost all of it to Goodwill. But, which is a charity shop, basically. But the magazines were really what I was after. And boy, did I score. I have a stack 2 feet high of French magazines, knitting magazines from the 1980s. And here is one of them. It is a men's issue of Georges Picot. France Tricot Spécial. That's right. This is actually, oh no, it's number 98. I have no idea what year this is from, but I am guessing sometime in the 80s because check out, you don't find men's sweaters with bow ties and mohair every day, people. Oh gosh, look at this one. That is all one piece. Oh yes, it is. The menswear is especially just look at this dude. That is all. Okay, so it's a little hard to see, but it's basically a shawl collar sweater that stops here. That's a black shirt with a black. And you thought novelty yarn was just for women. Well, what were you thinking? Oh my gosh, this guy is just fantastic. Oh, and Tarja in the 80s, they were just a match made in heaven. Yeah, there's a lot of great, and actually not all of it is terrible. Well, all of this is terrible. If you follow me on Instagram, you've seen this one already, because what? When was that ever okay? But like, okay, so this is still, I mean, it's boring, but it's completely wearable, right? So yeah, there's actually very, it's one of the reasons why I think these are really fun is that, it's not just fun to mock, but it's like, there's some good stuff in here. And I'm actually thinking kind of more along the mockery vein that if I get my act together, I'm going to start doing an Instagram series where I just post a photo of one of these every day and caption it, because there's just too much comic gold in here. The oldest magazine in this collection no longer has a cover, and I believe it is from, I'm not sure what year this is from, but I'm gonna guess it's early 60s just by the styling. And it is mostly, why is someone knocking on the door? Liam, not right now, please. I'll be out in a minute. It is a baby magazine, and it is a whole bunch of very sweet little layette pieces. I have to be very delicate with this because it is, it's kind of falling apart. But there are some very sweet things in here and some turbo weird things in here. Like, this is another one that I posted on Instagram because, like, hello, Ralphie from Christmas Story. What is going on here? But yeah, some very sweet things in there. There's all kinds of, family collections. Who would do this? I'm sorry if you have, but matching sweaters for the whole family is just, no. How about a dress with matching shoes? I love that. Dude, poses. Oh my gosh. Oh, gold lame, dynasty era. Yeah, what is this? This one's from 1984. Oh, yeah. You could have guessed that, right? If you were alive in the 80s, you know. You know what this is. Yeah, there's some Fildar in here. Oh, yeah, there's the color work. That is the color work of the 1980s, people. Not Fair Isle, in Tarja. Yes. Princess Diana sweaters everywhere. There's a really cool magazine of home decor in here. Look at that. What? That is so cool. I don't, what, this must be, this is a Swiss book, I think. And they've got all kinds of cool stuff in here that look terrible to make. Like, do you really want to knit a cover for your couch? Or that giant bedspread, but they're really awesome looking. So yeah, this one I'm very happy to have. There's a hilarious little faux cow rug, or bear, I don't know what that's supposed to be exactly. Here's another men's magazine. I have no idea, that's actually texture, like mohair. What is with the mohair in the menswear? It's just crazy town. But I think you could certainly, even if you don't read French, which I don't really, you could certainly make sense of this. I mean, it wouldn't be that hard, I think, to translate one of these patterns into something that you could follow. Just because the languages are so specialized, and if you followed enough, patterns in English, it shouldn't be that hard to figure out, I think. Look at the jewelry on this one. Dominoes. Dominoes were like a decorative thing in the 80s. I don't know what that was about. This is actually cute. This sweater. Yeah, I would make that. So some of this stuff doesn't go out of style, but actually, no, this one's all right. It's got some cool stuff in it. Where is this from? Of course, this is a Juniors magazine, so it probably doesn't even have my size in it. Bummer. Of course, the one that I like. There was even, I'm really excited about this one, there was a Stitch dictionary in here, which has all kinds of, like, color work, and lace. Cool. And then just a crap ton of Sandra and Mikado magazines. Oh my gosh, look at this one. This is a photo index of everything in the magazine. Look at this guy. Habana Deluxe. Oh yeah, you look like you're ready for your Cuban vacation, man. So hilarious. So yeah, super fun times for all. I can't wait to... I've been kind of slowly going through them and just having all kinds of hilarity from them. Okay. I am going to pause this, find out why the child was knocking on the door, figure out what I'm going to do for my technique segment real quick, and I'll be right back. Okay. So apparently it was very, very important for me to see the giant Nerf cannon that my child had bought at Target. I have now seen it. So, technique segment for today. Let's talk about measuring gauge. There are lots of things to say about measuring gauge, but I have one tip for you this week that fits into a whole panoply of tips that one could give, about which more another time. But here's one tip about gauge. When you measure gauge, and particularly when gauge really matters, there are times when gauge matters and when it doesn't really matter. A good pattern will tell you gauge doesn't matter in this pattern, or pay very close attention to stitch and row gauge in this pattern. Sometimes gauge doesn't matter. Sometimes, or it doesn't matter that much, like you're making a scarf. Does it really matter if the scarf is 4.5 inches wide or 5.25 inches wide? No, not really. Maybe it matters to you, but maybe it doesn't. So it, whatever. Gauge doesn't really matter. It will always matter in the sense that if you are going by, if the pattern is giving you an estimate of how much yarn it takes to make the pattern, and you're getting a different gauge, you will use a different yardage. So just be aware of that. But there are times when gauge sort of, it matters, but you could be, say, maybe a quarter stitch or a half stitch off, and it's not, like with a sweater, say, that's not going to so dramatically change the fit of a, say a fairly loose fitting sweater. It's not going to matter that much, or for mittens, say. But maybe, say, you've got a sweater that is pretty close fitting and every little bit of gauge counts. In those cases, here is what I would recommend. A lot of us are accustomed to measuring gauge with these retractable tape measures. There is a problem with measuring gauge with these, especially in those cases where refinement of gauge really matters. The problem is that especially if you use the same one over and over again, guess what happens? It's going to get stretched out. Subtly, perhaps, but enough that it could throw off your measurement, because you're actually... the distance between 0 inches and 1 inches, 1 inch, will, just stretch out ever so slightly so that you're actually getting a wrong gauge measurement. In those cases where your gauge really, really matters, use a ruler, something that does not stretch. This is just one I happen to have around that I, is also used for sewing, but it could be any ruler, just a standard school ruler is fine. But this is great because you can just, it will also not buckle in any way. You know, it won't, like, especially if you've got a ribbing or something, it won't, you know, kind of buckle into the ribbing. It'll just lie flat and give you a more accurate count. So that is my suggestion for gauge for this week. All right, lovies. I will see you in a couple of weeks. Bye.